So he is here. He hears our pleas. He hears our cries. He is so faithful. He just wants us to ask. So I ask you, if you have any prayers, don't keep them alone to yourself. Don't keep them stuffed in. Let your brothers and sisters in Christ intercede when you don't have the strength to pray for yourself. We want to pray for you. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go to Psalm 91, an awesome scripture that we have been declaring. I know many of you know it by heart. Many of you have been using it to fight your battles, and that is what we want. Amen? We want Jesus to fight our battles, but we need to be armed. Amen? We can't fight our battles without his weapons, which is the word, the sword. So let's go to Psalm 91. Okay. Christine? I'm not computer savvy, and she just left me.
Can't make it bigger.
There you go. Thank you. That's why it takes a body to in the church. Every member, it takes every member in the church. Amen? Okay, let's declare Psalm 91. And let's begin. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say to the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. And surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the flies by day, or the pestilence that walks in darkness, or the destruction that lays waste in noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you see the reward of the wicked.
Because you have the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Amen. Amen. God has a sense of humor. All these things are blank. And the Lord is like, you know it, so why do you keep looking at the screen? Well, I want to give you a little announcement before Pastor Street comes up. I wanted to catch you up on our walk for life. And we are so blessed and honored that our team has been going strong. Amen. We've raised over $2,000. We've already had quite a few people reach their goals and then increase their goals again. And two people have already reach their goals to get their t-shirts today, Sheila and Jonathan. So give them a clap of praise. We're so proud of you guys. I know that it's, for a lot of us, it's out of your comfort zone. But God doesn't call us to be comfortable. Whatever he asks us to do will always be uncomfortable. So we just have to remember why we're doing this. We're doing this because this is important to God and it pleases him. So whatever is important to him and pleases him, we should be on the same page. We should say, here I am, Jesus. Send me, I'll go. And you put on your boldness and you just keep going. You know, I'm so proud of Sheila, because Sheila, she just keeps going and going. And she's like, you know, I think that I would want people to donate larger amounts of money, but it all adds up. And that is true. It doesn't matter. You just keep on going, because God is the one that is in control. Amen? So if you have not signed up as a walker, we'd love to have you as a walker. We'd love for you to be on our team. And if you have not donated, you have not been able to sow a seed, please do that. We don't want you to miss out on this blessing. This is a blessing. Amen. So we thank you. And if you need to speak to us after service, you can speak to either myself or Christine, my co-captain. Awesome co-captain. She encourages me and kicks me in the butt when I'm behind. So we always need a right-hand person. Amen. And now Pastor Shree is going to bless us with the message. Be blessed.
All right. God is great. Amen.
Amen.
We serve a great God. While we were worshiping, or even before the worship started, the Lord has laid something on my heart to share with all of us. I don't know who it is. I'm just lining myself to it. You know, I have a sense of a release, and I have a sense of a life-changing or a great flow or great thing happening in a life, in someone's life. I'm not, if I have to say something, like if you are looking for something like a money breakthrough, or if you are looking for some kind of a breakthrough, all I have is a sense like some kind of a floodgate has been opened, and that greatness is hearing us in the name of Jesus. I have a sense to declare it is done.
Amen.
Come on, church. It is done. Amen.
Amen.
So I want us to be very, I have a sense, it's just one of those things, you know, when you know money is coming, you start thinking about how to spend, right? So I'm like that right now. You know, don't go into debt until the check comes, but it's time for us to get excited about what God is manifesting into our lives right now. God is manifesting himself strongly into our life, and it's going to be phenomenal on what we are going to see and what are all the things that we will be experiencing in our life. Amen.
Praise God.
All right, all right. So we are doing our Bible study on the First Corinthians, as we have been doing it for a little while. The purpose of this Bible study is purely this. You know, I'm one of those people, you know, from my childhood on, I think it is a God-instilled thing in me. If I know something, even though I may not know all of it, if I know something of a something, I want to share that something. So I always, it is not about, for me, you know, I was always from childhood on, I was very good at math. I always scored well. And so to all my friends, basically I am their tutor. The way I would teach them is, you know, when the teacher is teaching them or whatnot, all the complications of the steps up and down, they go through all that. But they all just sit through the class and everything is done. The test is coming. They're like, okay, how do we do this? They come to me. So there are many times I help my friends with their math situation right before their test. Like in an hour we will have a test, or in a half hour we will have a test. I will be breaking that to them at that hour. So sometimes my dad would get so upset at me because I would be getting calls first thing in the morning or late night or something like that. I would be getting calls from all my friends. Hey, what do we do about this? What do we do about that? They'll be calling me. My dad would get upset at me. Why won't you care about you? Then you are too caring about giving others. You know, I understood that concept because I never gotten like per se 100%. I would get somewhere between 90 to 95% score. That would be my score. My dad was like, why can't you put your effort and get yourself 100? But for me, I was more satisfied in being able to give someone else from that 90 to 95% I know. I had more joy in doing that. Even though I didn't understand then, what I learned from that is, as I was pushing myself to explain to them, I'm getting better at what I know. So God has given us a system where we give. The more we are able to give, the more God is willing to multiply back to us. If you ever want to grow in the revelation of the Lord, what are we doing with the revelation we have? And that is what you're doing. What you're doing is you're giving. And when you are processing through that revelation, when it is working, then you will be able to explain to someone out there in a very simplistic form. In an easier way that you can tell them, hey, you don't have to worry about all those things. All it takes is this. If someone comes to me saying, oh, algebra is complicated for me, I laugh at them. Even though I stopped doing algebra for a long time, I still can get into it. My son comes and asks things and discusses things with me. And I try to explain it to him in different ways. And we come to solutions, we solve things. To the point, I was surprised and joyful the other day. His own school, in their curriculum, they made a mistake. And he was able to identify that mistake and tell them, like, oh, this is wrong. And he proved it, why it is wrong, going backwards. I was like, yeah, that's my son. I was always interested in debating with my lecturers than with my colleagues. Because a lot of the lecturers came just memorizing those things and just blobbed it out rather than knowing the stuff. But anyway, the point I'm going after is whatever we have been given, we have been given the task also to give it. And one of the most important things, I believe, I am not good at many things. That is just, I'm being very honest. I'm not good at many things. But one thing I have learned from God is how to be strong in the Spirit. How to be strong in the Spirit. So far, if I have gone through hell, yes, I've been through hell. A lot of you haven't even touched the boundaries of the hell I lived through. But I lived through all of it. Not only I lived through them, I came through them and I came out of them. And I can boldly say that I don't even smell the smoke of it. This is not for me to brag about me. This is for me to glorify God that His word is true. And it comes to pass in our lives. And it works effectively in our lives. And if I really want to give something to somebody, I really don't care to give you my theological efficiency or anything like that. I like to give you something that would build your spirit. That's the only thing I look for. This is probably, that's one of those things, that map that I know is what I am trying to give. Because I know this works. The spirit that has been built in him, how it has helped me in spite of losing anything and everything, losing in spite of not finding a way for me no matter where I went. I couldn't find a way. But bless God, my spirit man always plowed through. My spirit man always pushed me through. My spirit man always made way. He's like, you know, there are people, how can you do that with bare hands? Yes, with the Spirit of the Lord, you can go through things that you don't even be able to do it in your own strength. There are many things, many barriers, many things that you can break if your spirit is bold enough and operating in the true strength of your spirit. That's why this Bible study is one of those things very dear to me, because it is about the spiritual gifts. As I have been mentioning, I'll repeat myself again. This is not about the gifts of the Spirit, but it is your spirit, the born again spirit, the gifts, the attributes, the qualifications or the qualities of your spirit. You know, sometimes I'm blessed to have these women of God in my life. They are they come and tell me, you know what? I'm able to see things in my spirit better now than ever in my life. They've been to church for the last 50 years, but now they say, hey, you know what? I'm seeing it differently. I can operate it differently. I do things differently. What a glorifying testimony. How much God loves us and how much God cares for you. You think you are too old, but God says, no, no, no. Let me start a new story in your life now. This gives me more excitement to go and open the Bible now more than yesterday. Okay. I want to hear more from God. God direct me. God speak to me. God, oh my, sometimes it just blows my mind. How in the world I have this revelation, Lord? Someone like me. I think about me and I'm like, okay, I know I'm not qualified for this. As a matter of fact, I'm not a good speaker either. I know that too. I rub people off in the wrong way. I know that too. But let me tell you something. This is what you got. Live with it. Right? But the truth, the God giving that to me, how am I able to do that is very simple. You know, when the magnet becomes stronger, the ions are lining up. What happens? It can attract more things. It's the same thing for you. Your spirit is your magnet that attracts the things of the Lord, that attracts the manifestation of God. Your spirit, not your crying. I respect your crying, but not your crying. Bring your spirit up. Not your complaint, not your compromise, not your sin, none of those things. But let your spirit grow up that it can find you. You don't even know where those monies are coming. I just want us to be in a place where all can be found. They come attracted to you. They come running to you because you're too big and too powerful for them to be hanging out there. They have to come because once you come up, boom, they have to be attracted. And now you can see it in a different light. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. And even the Deuteronomy 28, it says in that, the blessings will overtake you. In other words, you're not even looking for it, it happens. You know, you're not even looking for, it brings me some great joy, like when my wife tells me, oh, how do you know I'm just looking for this? Because she never told me that, but I'll bring it to her. Yeah, I still have some romance in me, but anyway, but the thing is, like, we being able to do that, and the things that are out there, they're going to come finding you. Not because you are in need of it, not because you said, I want this, but they will be coming. Imagine this thing, you don't even need something and that comes and parks in your driveway. Imagine that. You're not even praying for it. You're not even fasting for it. And there comes. Amen. I just don't want us to be stuck in just that survival mode. Let us be where our spirit is growing every day strong, that it will find whatever it needs to find. Many times we are not able to breathe because we are stuck in a realm that you don't belong. You know, I think the best visual example I can talk about is this. If anyone, one of you have watched the movie, Hobbit movie. These people go into this wilderness or this forest. And they are loopy there. They're looping and looping and they get mad and upset at each other. And they are getting ready to kill each other. All because they are dwelling under that forest. In the middle of all these people, this hobbit climbs up the tree. And then he says, you know what? This is where the fresh air is. Let's come up. And they're able to see their destiny. They're able to see their vision. Some of you, I believe, has to learn how to come up. Come up. Because you're not able to catch your breath. You know, everything you see around is falling apart. Everything that is around us is breaking. Everything around us, it seems like everything is against us. Sometimes it just feels like a mobster have hired a group of people that are going to hit us one after another after another. Every day it seems like it. It's because we are circling around in a realm that you don't belong. Which is your natural realm, that human realm. I'm a human, you know, quit lying to yourself. You're better than God? God said you're a spirit, so be it. You're a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. That's the end of your story. Don't make the body too big. The weakest part of you is your body. So don't exalt it. Don't depend on your weak things. Anytime when you're doing a teamwork, do you depend on the weak person? If you really want to have a success, you're always leaning on the strong person, right? But we do the opposite. We depend on the weak person to get the better results of our life, which is our flesh. Our flesh always gives us bad results. But your spirit can always maximize your result. Can take you to a place that you can never, ever go in your physics. That's why it's important that we build our spiritual gifts, we build our spiritual acumen, we build our spiritual reputation. Amen. Let me tell you this thing. Let me tell you this thing with much respect. God is not going to respond to your cry before He responds to your spirit. Period. Oftentimes we think, oh Lord, let me help me, oh God, help me, God, I'm drowning, help me out. God is going to respond to you. That's why I always say, if that's the case, God should only be in Africa. None of y'all deserve God and His answer. They have more struggles and troubles than you and me. That is not how God responds. Build your spirit and see how God flows. And see how heaven flows for you. You're not at the mercy of anything. Have you ever seen Jesus being at the mercy of anything? When there was no money, He wasn't waiting for money. He found money. When there was sickness, He found it. When there was lack of food, He wasn't at the mercy of anything. I'm challenging every one of our thinking. We cannot be living at the mercy of somebody or something. When our spirit is built, it automatically attracts. It attracts what needs to come to you. It's all about that ionization. How well we are willing to let the Spirit of God work in us. How well we are going to let the Spirit of our spirit continue to build in us. Biggest problem is our mind. You are not renewing your mind. You're still thinking your old thinking and expecting a new results. It's never going to happen. As a man thinketh, so is he. Your results will exactly match your thinking. I thank my God, chapter 1, verse 4. This is our base verse. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given to you by Christ Jesus, that you were enriched in everything by Him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. So that you come short in no gift. Eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, remember, God said that you may not lack any good thing. The most important good thing for you is your spirit. First Corinthians chapter 11. This is where we are going now. Imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. That is a statement of boldness. Let's be very honest. How many of us here can say that to anybody? Imitate me. Imitate me. Think about that. We just need to ponder on that for a minute. Like right now, we always try to tell our children. We always try to teach people around us. We want them to learn. We want them to do things. We want them to do differently. But you do differently. You know, do as I do. Don't do as I do, but do as I say. Right? There is no power to it. There is never power to it. You know, there is a responsibility there. There is a power in there. And then there is a boldness in there. He is trapping himself to it. Think about that. How many of us, we don't want to promise ourselves too much because we know we will fall and fail. Yes, that is so true. You got to be very careful and cautious. But how much of us are making an effort that we are putting ourselves out there? Let me strive to be like Him. Be like Christ. The biggest journey you and me can be on is you being like Christ. That is you. It's no longer that you live. I live for Christ. No, you don't. You shouldn't. You don't live for Christ. You live in Christ. There's a huge difference to all these things. We, you know, God is a top priority. You know, God is not even a priority for me. He doesn't cut my priority list. He is the sole life. After that comes any priorities for me. He's not in that same league of my priorities. He can't be. He shouldn't be. Amen? Any other thing that comes, yeah, my wife is my top priority on this earth. But, you know, I always tell her, even in the beginning, it was hard for her to hear this. But I told her, let me tell you something. I love God more than you. Amen. She was, as any woman, she was like, oh, you love somebody else more than me? That's all she heard. You know, women have selective hearing, right? That's all she heard. She heard, I love someone more than her. But I got to tell her, no. I love our Savior more than you so that I can continue to love you. Yes. Otherwise, I'm a mess. Right. I'm going to be a disaster in your life if I don't do that. I'm going to destroy you. That's why it is so important. I don't want to give you that priority without me putting God at that place, at that seat. There is no competition to Him. My children every day will be taught that thing. Jesus comes first. I don't care where you are, what you're doing. Jesus is the number one. Before I teach them, oh, you, do you love Daddy? I teach them, Jesus loves you. That is the most important base and the bed of our life. If not, we don't have anything to live for. We're always falling and we're always failing. My kids, I don't mind if they forget me. But I truly mind if they forget Jesus. They can forget my culture. They can forget my brought up. Or they can forget the memories that I built with them. I could care less. Maybe it might sting. I don't know. But I truly care for them to have the strong relationship with their Savior. I want them to grow every day in the fear of the Lord. Not me. Not me. They don't have to live for my standards. But they have to do every day. I encourage them every day. Can you be that for your God? Imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. And we complain about the world being dark. We complain about, look, the world is going to hell in a handbasket. Guess why? We did not depict heaven to them. We depicted hell to them as His church. Every day we painted hell to them. So what will they? Where will they go? We ourselves don't know how to conquer hell. Every day our decisions that we are making, the thought process that we are going through, some of you are waiting for the hell that Jesus have created. I'm here to tell you, do you know the hell that you created? How many of you believe you created in the image of God? Do you believe that? If God created heaven and hell, don't you think you have the ability to create heaven and hell? I'm not that worried about the hell that God has created before I'm worried about the hell that you create. Many of you are living in the hell that you created. You created for yourself. Be honest with yourself. The more you are honest with yourself, I created this hell. When you can be real and honest with yourself in that line, you'll be able to figure out how am I going to come out of this hell. That is where the resurrection power becomes real to us. The only way that you are going to get out of your hell is through resurrection. Hell requires death. Hell requires death. That's why Jesus had to die. But heaven requires resurrection. You cannot build a heaven. He cannot go to heaven unless and until He was resurrected. Remember that. As long as Jesus was on this earth, He didn't go to heaven. Until He was resurrected. Amen? Something fresh, right? Now there are some things that He deals with here that seems trivial, that is something simple, but I want you to understand something. Sometimes we have a lopsided view about protection. What is protection? Protection can look like control. Protection can look like control. And many times as a father, I want my children, my child to be in my view. If the child looks at it, the child thinks I'm controlling the child. But what I am trying to offer to that child is, if you are not here, I can't protect you. If you are not around me, if you are not in this view, I can't protect you. So this one, I want us to see with that view. It's an offer of protection to us, not a control. Though the society tried to teach this in a controlling format. Every time society skews it, it tries to bring that villainy into everything God does. You know why? Because we can take offense quickly. You are too quick to be offended. I'm here to challenge every one of us. If there is one of the things that you want to exercise on not getting offended. Give the freedom to freedom to the people around you to say no to you. Give them that freedom. Give them the freedom to tell you are wrong. That's where you are truly growing in your spirit. Until you come to that place, until you accept that suffering in a way, that is your sacrificial giving unto the Lord. Remember, Bible clearly says that you may live, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Every day it's gonna continue to go. As long as you live, there is a room for sacrifice. Even though we are not sacrificing somebody else, you know, we are good at sacrificing things that doesn't even matter. Oh, I'm fasting Starbucks. So what? You're making more money for yourself anyway. That's not the point. The point is, what are we sacrificing that is of our flesh that we are willing to give at the altar? Oh, I gave my pork at the altar. Where are you going to go? You ain't going to special heaven. It's the same heaven you're going to go. So that we try to use and excuses and all these kinds of things. You know, we are in this season, what a lot of the church celebrates around as a Lent season. They give up on these things. I know, I grew up all around it. All my family, a lot of my family members that are drunkards, they would give up alcohol for those 40 days. And they are waiting, eagerly waiting for Easter. When will the Easter come so they can get drunk? Is that truly a sacrifice? Now I praise you, brethren, second verse. Now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the traditions just as I delivered them to you. But I want you to know that the head of every man is, come on, is
Christ.
The head of a woman is?
Amen.
The head of Christ, and the head of Christ is?
God.
So you have to understand these things. God, Christ, man, woman. It's not about man like we think about individual man. It's a husband and wife. That is whom we are talking about. So I will rewrite it simply like this. God, Christ, husband, wife. Okay, why we need to do what we need to do? If you want to operate in an institution, you need to know who is your boss. If you keep running against your own boss, you know you are fired. That is what happens many times. We don't know our boss. We try to, I want that chair. No, the chair is your boss's. Let the boss make his own mistakes. Why are you running to his chair? Everybody has their own payment to pay. Isn't that why Christ had to own me? That's why he paid that kind of price. Even though the society that we are living in about this equal rights and equal, not even equal rights, it's equity right now. Which is, equity simply means equal outcome. Last time I checked, nobody can do equal outcomes unless you are robots. And God has never created us to have equal outcomes. Everything is unique. The uniqueness is what God encourages us. To have an opportunity that gets us to a place where we can thrive as you. Not as someone else. I don't want to be like you. I want to be like me. Amen? Every man, I'm going to go on. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies, there are a few things I wanna think about here. There is another scripture where it says women are not to preach in the church. They shouldn't pastor. There are some denominations that are out there, they won't allow women to preach. I'm not here to argue or disagree with you. The thing that I am saying here is, it is so clear, women are allowed to pray and prophesy. They are allowed to pray and prophesy. That is their place. That is their position. Amen? So the simple point that I want us to remember, instead of getting, you know, it's always we get caught on what not to. Rather than what we can. What not to is the law. What we can is the grace. There is a difference between those two things. Every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. For that is one and the same as if her head were shaved. For a Western woman, this is a strange thing. But me, coming from an Indian background, I'll explain it to you very easily. A woman's hair gets shaved only once, when her husband is dead. That is part of the culture. A woman will be shaved, her head is shaved, to portray to everybody that she lost her husband. Whether it is good or bad, I'm not here to argue those kinds of things, but that was the tradition. So here what he is saying is, if you don't allow this covering to cover you, if you are not covering yourself, you may as well be a widow. In other words, when we don't appreciate the authority that has been put in our lives, we may as well put ourselves out there where we are prone to anybody and everything. This is also another thing that we have to understand. Man has been put in a responsibility, or a husband has been put in a responsibility, that he has to cover his wife. If some intruder is coming, it is the husband's job to go first. That is one of the reasons I appreciate the Second Amendment. As a husband, I may be facing a 6 foot or 7 foot thug that is coming and trying to invade my life. I have an obligation from God to protect her. So it becomes different now. It's not about carrying a gun. It's about having the ability to protect. Some of you might say, oh, guns were not there in the Bible. Yeah, that's true. There were swords. The criminals came with swords. Now they come with guns. So, yeah, there's a difference of that too. But again, people don't understand, oh, I'm going to ban... I don't know. I'm going to ban all the guns. Let me ask you a simple question. How did Cain kill Abel? Yeah, why not we ban the stones? The evil that is in us is going to continue to have its way. Whether you have a gun or not, the evil is going to have its way. So don't try to do all this garbage to justify your own agendas. But anyway, for here he goes on, for a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God. But woman is the glory of man. See, the connection here giving is, I am as a man, if I am not under Christ, I lose my protection. I lose my protection. If I don't have that protection, there is no way I can protect anybody or anything that is under me. If you truly want to understand this thing, the best way you can understand is study mafia. Mafia is all about protection. Who protects whom? That is how it runs. Who protects whom? Basing on that, they will give you the covering or non-covering. If you know, okay, this family is under this family, so I'm not going to touch them. Because this family is going to come after me if I touch this choker. So we have to understand how God operates. He operates in such a way that he offers himself as a protection to us, but it has to be in that order. How many of you believe God respects order? He's a God of order, not a confusion. He's not gender confused, like how we are trying to propagate all around. He's not confused about anything. He knows you are his son. He knows you are his daughter. He knows you by your name. He says clearly, even before you were formed in your mother's womb, I know you. Do not try to rewrite what God has written. That is our problem. We are always trying to mitigate God's plan. Every time we do that, we inherit something called sin. From the Garden of Eden till now, it's the same thing. We try to mitigate with God's plan. When God clearly said, so and so be it. Yes, it is uncomfortable sometimes. I agree, truly agree with you. But that's not the point here. Did God say that? Remember, Satan, how Satan comes. Did God really say you cannot eat the fruit of the tree? Did God really say you cannot be bisexual or homosexual? Did God really say I cannot commit adultery? Did God The moment we are questioning those kinds of things, the moment we are setting ourselves to fail in his kingdom. For man is not from woman. He's talking about the Adam. That Adam was not from the woman, but woman from man. Right? Nor was man created for woman, but woman for the man. For this reason, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. I'm going to go a little more here. You know, even though we are trying to fight, protest, and all these kinds of things, I want us to understand many times we are failing in our marriages, which is one of the most effective institutions on this earth, because we don't take the protection that is being offered. Even in the church, God offers that protection to us. That's why he put someone as pastor. That's why someone is an apostle. Someone is an evangelist. Someone is a prophet. Someone is a teacher. They have been given to us that they may offer protection to us. Not only they are responsible for our protection, but they are also responsible for our well-being. Remember where Paul writes in the book of Philippians, where he writes, my God who has anointed me and appointed me as an apostle is the same God who will meet all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. So instead of taking advantage of the system, no, I want to be like you. This is what we have created for ourselves. I never want to be a manager. Let the manager do his job, I will do my job. I don't want your position. Your position is secure in your position. See, this is where God says, do not covet others. Because with that comes a lot of responsibility, a lot of burden. See now what the Hollywood have done to our society. You have been duped and pressured every single day as a woman. Oh, you got to live independent. You have to be this. You have to be that. Now look at the stress-related diseases women are inheriting now. 90-95% of the sickness a woman has on this earth is because of stress. Because she is forced to play a role that God has not anointed them for. And we bought that lie. Trust me, I love and respect women. I respect my wife. I respect my mother. I respect any woman that is in my life. I appreciate them. I love them like my mothers, my sisters, my own. I glean off of them. I always pray for them. There is nothing. I don't have any disrespect for them. But I'm here to tell every one of us, let us play our roles effectively so we may contribute well to our society rather than trying to do whatever we want to do. Remember, I always said this statement. I tell you again, a healthy marriage begets healthy family. A healthy family begets a healthy society. A healthy society begets a healthy nation. You want to fix the nation? Fix the marriage. We're trying to throw problem money, throw things, throw wars, throw everything at problems. It will never get fixed until marriage is resolved. Satan knows that very well. That's why he plays against it so much. in the pretense of trying to empower you, empowering women. I'm empowering everybody. You are the best self of you. You go marry a guy. No, you are annulling the power of God's marriage. God has given you right, yeah, to go to hell. So that doesn't mean you should go to hell. Oh, that is God's love. No, yeah, God's love lets you do whatever you want because He respects your self-will. He's not a controlling God. He's a loving Father. But that doesn't mean He will approve. Nevertheless, neither is man independent. 11th verse. Nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman. Can somebody say independent? There is no such thing called independent. If that lie is being told to you, that's a lie from the pit of hell. We are interdependent. You need me, I need you. That is how God's system works. We are never independent. We can celebrate July 4th all we want, but we cannot prosper without other nations around. We cannot be a nation without other nations being around. We need each other. That's the same system in our society. We need each other. How much are you willing to depend? Look at the society that we are living in right now. We don't even want to ask a cup of sugar from our neighbor. Because Amazon is going to drop it at your home, at your doorstep. Or there is DoorDash that is going to bring to you. But I'm here to challenge everyone. Let us step up and see how you can continue to still interact with people. It's not that you are struggling to have a cup of sugar. It's about you are stop being independent. Because we need each other. We need each other. If we don't have that mindset of we need each other, what do? We create those individual isolated silos. And here I am to tell you, isolation is the devil's playground. He plays us very badly when we are isolated. He can make you believe nobody is there for you. If he can get you into that corner, you're dead. That's why even if I don't have anybody, when I first came to the United States of America, I do not have one relative here. I did not. But I went and grabbed anybody and everybody that is willing to come to my house, that is willing to come to my family. I grabbed anybody. Come eat with me. Come do this with me. Come. I wanted them. I don't care if you want me or not. I am dependent. If you really want to be smart, learn to be dependent. I am dependent on my wife. I am dependent on my wife. I made myself so dependent, I don't even know what's my bank account. Look at this weird thing, right? I'm the best one with math and my wife hates math. But God wants her to deal with my finances. Now I'm dependent on her. Sometimes she just, Lord, I can do this math in my sleep. Why am I asking her? But I am dependent on her. The more I see that, okay, I'm dependent on her. I got to be depending on her. That is how I am empowered. By us depending on each other. We are too caught up in this pride, self-sufficiency. We want to be so self-sufficient that we kick everybody out. That is exactly what the devil wants. Your biggest downfalls are when you kicked everybody out. If you don't believe that, have a replay. You will find it clearly. Nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman is independent of man in the Lord. For as woman came from man, even so man also comes through woman. But all things are from God. Look at the beauty of justification, how he justified. How he created a justice system here. Yes, I created a woman from the man, but now this is the same woman through whom I'm going to bring a man. Who is important? Judge among yourself. Is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is dishonor to him? But if a woman has long hair, it is glory to her. For her hair is given to her for a covering. But if anyone seems to be contentious, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. This is not about the customs. This is not about the traditions. This is not about that. This is about having a covering. Look at how many of our children are growing every day without a covering. The devil has them like that every day. Every day, every day. Because what the devil have done is very simple. He created a divide between man and woman. Politicians played his play in dividing man and woman, in dividing husband and wife. And then came this equal rights or whatever. Why do you want to be equal to me? You and me can be different. You and me has to be unique. That's what makes this equation so good. If you and me are the same, what's the point? We are never bringing anything new. You know, everybody tries to sell a lie. Oh, it's oppressive. That is oppressive. This is oppressive. No, no, no. In all reality, you will have more prosperity when you have the covering rather than when you don't. But if anyone seems to be contentious, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. Now I'm going to the next level of this thing. It looks like a common tradition that goes on around us. We are ignoring the spiritual implications of things. That is why it's important. Why do I do this thing? Not for someone to approve of me, but because this is how I do offer my covering to my wife. This is how I can offer my covering to the church. This is how I can offer my whatever I can be. I want to offer that covering. That is my call. I got to offer that. When I am in need of a covering, cover me. I need that covering. I can't be open. I am not. I can't do this thing all the time. How many times I ask you, I beg you many times, pray for me. I need your covering. At the same time I offer to you, I am praying for you. We need to cover. We are too open outside. We are too open outside. Many businesses have all these other things. They have these departments that offer this HR, and there are these departments that offer this psychological evaluations and all these kinds of things. I'm here to ask, who is the spiritual covering for you? If anybody and everybody can think in that line, for my business, for my partnership, for my venture, for my job, I need a spiritual covering. God offers that covering for us. That's why you don't go out on your own. Be that somebody who we sent, not went. You put yourself out there. Many times people attract so much of trouble because they stopped being that magnet, that spiritual magnet they ought to be. They become this physical thing, that natural thing that they depend on so much that they forget how much they lost them in the process of being something else. What time is it? Oh, 8:32. I still didn't even make through this thing. But anyway, I'll read it quickly. You have 5 minutes for me. You know, even if you don't, I'll take it anyway. Now, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you came together not for the better, but for the worse. For first of all, when you come together as church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and in part I believe it. For there must also be factions among you, that those who approved may be recognized among. This is one of the reasons I don't do memberships in our church. Nobody, I don't want anybody to be pulling ranks. As a church, we are not called to pull ranks. As a church, we are called to serve each other. Not pull the ranks. Oh, I'm a deacon, I get to sleep with anybody. No, you don't. I've seen enough of those things all around. Let me be very clear to you. I hate them. Because that creates a spirit of division, not a spirit of unity. If I'm a deacon, I should be serving you more, not making you serve me. Therefore, when you come together in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's supper, for in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others. This is not about who gets the best place. It's about us coming together. One is hungry, another is drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? You want to pull a rank, pull somewhere else, not in the church. Or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I do not praise you. If you ask me, where did you get your way of talking? Let me tell you, Paul doesn't talk any better than me. He tells it like it is, right? For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. Think about this thing. This should blow us all. The day he was betrayed is the same day he is offering himself more. Glory be to God in heaven. Do you have the heart to be that? The day you are betrayed is the same day you are offering yourself more. Think about the challenge. The day he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you." He's extending himself more. Because Judas cannot stop me. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." That is one of the reasons in Covenant Fusion Church, we will always have a communion here, no matter which service we are in. We want to remember. "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and or drinks this cup of the Lord is in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of the bread and the drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." Do you see in the church people tell you how to judge yourself? Some churches don't even offer you communion because you're not their church member. It ain't church job to judge you. It's between you and your God. You have some issues with your God, you clean it up. Not my job. It's not me who is going to hell. You will. If you have issues, why would I do someone else's job? We're trying to control everything when the Lord says, open it up. If there is something between you and them, me and them, it's between me and them. I will deal. Let that be your own conviction. Amen. For if we, this is any very important here, not discerning the Lord. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Many are dead for this reason. They don't understand the freedom of this. And because when we can participate and partake in this communion, you also need to remember your healing is in His body. His body that is broken, by His stripes you were healed. Whenever you're partaking in the communion, you're also receiving the healing power of Jesus Christ into your life. You're not only covered in the body of Christ, you're also covered in the healing of the Lord. If we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by God, and that we may not be condemned with the world. Therefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment. And the rest I will set in order when I come. Paul is like, wait till I come. It sounds like my dad's threat on the phone. But are we bold enough to say, imitate me? I like for us to think on that. Have you learned, you know, as a father, I like for my son to learn the skills that I have, learn the things that I know. But I want him to learn how I worship God, how I imitate God. I want him to learn from that. I want my children to grow in that. Have you learned how to imitate Christ? That's a learning that we can focus on. How can I imitate Christ? Lord, help me how to imitate you today. How can I imitate you? For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. World's best weapon against a believer is condemnation. You will never go down until condemnation hits you. But Bible clearly says, therefore, now there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus, no condemnation. We don't live under condemnation. God gives us conviction. Conviction of sin. Yes, you messed it up. Not for you to be condemned. Condemned means you are left alone to die. Conviction is for you to repent. Lord, I blew it up. Forgive me. Help me so I can stay back on the course. Many times our repentance is about saying sorry, sorry, sorry. No, it's about getting back on our feet. Don't you get irritated by your child if all the child offers is sorry and never changes what they do? Why would you expect differently with your father? I pray that we will grow in this thing. Understand the protection that God has offered for us. Spiritually, that's the spiritual force that God has given to us. Maybe society doesn't require it. Maybe the world doesn't require it. But for you who is not of the world. You are in this world but not of the world, right? When we are not of the world's order, let us not also limit ourselves to the world's order. Let us focus more on being in the spiritual order. May the protection of the Lord be upon us, upon our children, upon our children's children, now and forever. Amen. Let us end our service with our confession. 3, 2, 1. We are Covenant Fusion Church. We are a body of believers. And we are blessed to be a blessing. And we are filled for His glory. Amen. God bless you. We love you.